Greetings. It is the 13th of January, and MetaGaming is finally back. We are going to do our review of games from 2016 today. I am Llama Chomp, and I will be joined today by my co-host Lollash.
Hi, Llama. How you doing?
I am well. I'm well. I'm excited to finally do this show. We've been preparing for a little while.
Yeah, we had to have a bit of a chat and sort of decide on the format and stuff we wanted to do. We needed to be able to talk about all the games that we loved from 2016. There were a few of them as well. Sort of narrowing down the list was a bit tricky, but we finally did it. We've come up with what we think is a great selection of games from 2016.
Yeah.
It's probably worth mentioning that we're going to be going through these really quickly.
Yep.
If you want in-depth thoughts, you'll have to either, you know, ask us during one of our streams or go back through and look at some of the older episodes we did on MetaGaming, because we've covered a lot of these games in depth before. But today, yeah, we've got a few to get through, so
also,
we'll be doing it fairly quickly.
This is sort of our best games of the year cast, but I am terrible at picking favorites. I like things for different reasons, and my brain can't put one above the other without 1,000 caveats. So I am just not going to try. We're going to go through a bunch of different things in a bunch of different categories, and that's how we're going to talk about them. We're not going to try and have a best.
Yeah, it's very difficult to pick out a best, because games are good for different reasons. And you'll see some games that you might think, yeah, that definitely could be the top game of the year in a category, and then you'll see another game in a category that's like, well, that could definitely be the best game of the year too. Like, how do you choose? So we're going to do our best and just present a bunch of categories. Where are we going to start today, Llama? What are we going to start with?
We are going to start with our honorable mentions category. We have two games in there for different reasons.
Yeah. So honorable mentions is basically games that, are good. You know, they were good games. Release was fine. But maybe they're not quite up to the standard that they could be. Maybe
yeah,
they need a little bit more polish.
Yeah, basically, this is the category for games we felt like probably should be mentioned, but that we didn't quite want to put in a best of list.
Exactly, yeah. All right. So, let's start out with Total War Warhammer.
Total War Warhammer. So, to me, Total War Warhammer would get something like my, this game was half an hour too long award. I had a great time when I first launched it. This was my first Total War game. I love the Warhammer universe. I played the dwarves, and they were dwarfy. And, you know, Warhammer does really good at atmosphere. And then by the end of the game, I was like, why am I still playing this? When did I stop having fun?
It's a big problem with Total War games, and always has been. You know, when you get towards the end, it does tend to drag on a little bit. For me, Total War Warhammer ends up in the honorable mentions category because it had a fantastic launch, which is great for Creative Assembly. They've ballsed a few of them up in the past. Fantastic launch, some great content that came out with the original game. But I think that down the line, after some more races are available and there's some more depth in the game and you're not fighting the same enemies all the time, I think the game will become more interesting and more tactical. And I think that will add a lot of value to the game. And it's just not quite there yet. It's getting there,
yeah,
but it's just not quite there yet. I think that's why it ends up in the honorable mentions category for me.
Yeah. And we have both of our honorable mentions. The next one that we're going to talk about had roughly the same problem for me, which was, I was really excited about it, and it started off really, really fun. And then instead of being an hour too long, it was a few hours, the way you put it while we were prepping. It was a few hours too middle.
Yeah, it was a few hours too middle. So Stellaris is the game that we're going to be talking about next. The space-based grand strategy game from Paradox Interactive. Their first non-historical grand strategy game.
Yeah. That was one of the reasons we had such great hopes for it, was they're not constrained to history. So some of the issues that made their other games really complex and really hard to get into can be designed around, because they have a lot more freedom. And in general, that was pretty true in the early game.
Yeah, I think that really showed through with Stellaris. Mm-hmm. The early game of Stellaris was way more interesting than the early game in any of their previous grand strategy titles.
And it was also easier to get into because, you know, in their grand strategy titles, they're dumping you into history and everything already exists. In Stellaris, for me, it was so much better that they introduced mechanics one at a time, because they could, because your technology was developing into those mechanics, and that was so nice.
Yeah. The big problem for me with Stellaris is, and it's a problem that all grand strategy games struggle from a little bit, is that once you get into the mid-game, they tend to stall out. They don't have to. You can play a very aggressive style of game, but they tend to stall out as you tech up and prepare to, you know, fight wars on multiple fronts and things. And the middle part of the game just didn't have that same sense of exploration and adventure that the early stages of the game had. There's been some patches that have started to work towards correcting that. There's been a lot more story arcs included, balance changes, things like that.
Which is what we expect from Paradox. They're very good at supporting their games after launch. And Stellaris may be worth more than an honorable mention in 2017.
I think, I think this year, by the end of this year, Stellaris will have crept up to, you know, being one of the best releases of 2016, unfortunately, be about 12 months too late. So, Stellaris, great game, really good fun, supported by the developers, and definitely worth a mention. But I think that it still needs a little bit of work before it hits, like, the truly great game sort of category.
For sure. Our next category, those were our two honorable mentions. Our next category is the, these kind of came out in 2016 category. We don't know if we're allowed, I'm going to put in giant air quotes, to have these on our 2016 gaming year in review list, but we're doing it anyway.
That's the great thing about being like a completely arbitrary selection made by just us, governed by just us. It's great. It's like, just like the Grammys. First game we want to talk about, I'm going to harp on a little bit here, RimWorld. RimWorld came to Steam in 2016. That's my excuse for talking about it. Technically, it's still in alpha and not released.
Yeah. So then we get to talk about it again in a year or two, because we'll have another excuse that it got released.
RimWorld's a great game. I play tons of RimWorld.
Yeah.
It simulates the environment great. It has amazing, like, emergent storytelling. The soundtrack's incredible. I just feel like with every alpha, the game only gets better and only gets deeper. And I don't think there's anything I can fault about the game. There are some mechanics that frustrate me at times.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it is just one of the best, if not the best, colony simulation I have ever played in my life.
Yeah, for me, RimWorld strikes a great balance. I love Dwarf Fortress for its depth of simulation and its emergent story. Right? In Dwarf Fortress, you get to... But the thing that RimWorld does better than Dwarf Fortress is it shows you the story. In Dwarf Fortress, you have to do too much work to extract it. And RimWorld displays it very well right on the surface. But somehow without giving up all of the depth of simulation and all of the ridiculous interactions. And it's somehow managed to strike what I thought before RimWorld, what I thought was an impossible balance.
Which is Dwarf Fortress with a graphical interface. It's just, it's a great game. It's can't sing its praises highly enough. So it kind of came out in 2016. There was another game that kind of came out in 2016. It also kind of came out in 2012 and will probably come out in 2017.
Yeah, this is another one that, like, we're putting on this list and our excuse is, it hit Steam. You can buy it on Steam as of this year.
You can also, we can also put this on the list because they released the big multiplayer patches, and I think that made a huge difference to the game.
Yeah.
Factorio,
I almost want to put in another one of our categories that's coming up later.
Yeah.
It would have fit equally well.
We can insert it twice. I have no problem with putting Factorio in twice.
This is a game, we could make a new category for this game, which would be impossible to describe to your friends. You know, when someone looks at you and says, well, it's a automator game. Like, what? What do I do with those words?
Factorio is addictive.
Yeah.
It just tickles that part of my brain that loves puzzles.
Mm-hmm.
And the puzzles are of your own creation. There is so much design space in that world.
Factorio, I had, Factorio made me re-examine my own brain because I had thought I didn't like open-ended sandboxes because I run out of motivation to do the thing. And Factorio managed to keep motivating me despite being sandboxy.
I think the key to Factorio's success is not the actual, like, veneer over the top of the gameplay. I think it's the core gameplay. I think at the end of the day, Factorio always presents you with a problem.
Yep.
You know, you can play 100 hours developing a base, and unless you spend 100 hours planning that base perfectly, at the end of that 100 hours, you will have supply shortages. You will have things that are not being produced in the right quantities. You will have, you know, new minerals that you have to mine because your patches have worn out. There is always something to do. And that's so important in a sandbox game.
Yep. Game is great.
It's great.
It would also fit in the, oh no, what happened to all of Saturday and Sunday category?
Yeah, yeah. The, oh, what time is it? Yesterday?
Yeah. It does such a good job. RimWorld has this quality as well. It does such a good job of pacing itself to where somehow you spend every second of the game on the verge of failure and always sort of scrambling to put the next thing in place that you need. And somehow they manage to pace that so that it feels right and it's fun and it's engaging the whole time.
Game's really good. Game is really good.
Yep.
Both of those games technically have been playable since before 2016, but both of them hit Steam this year. Both of them got a lot more exposure because of Steam this year, and I think that both of them are really well supported and have fantastic developers behind them that listen to the community, and that elevates them to amazing status. They're up there with the Prison Architects and the KSPs, as far as I'm
concerned. Another name for this category could be the Early Access Done Correctly category.
Yeah. Yeah. Both games in Early Access, both. To be honest, it's funny to me that both games are still in Early Access, because really, both of those games are like full releases.
Yeah,
I would buy either of those games today for full price and not expect any more content. So. Yeah.
Good games. Our next category is the story category. We had to split this category. We wanted to have a writing category, and we split it into two sections. One is story, and the other is atmosphere that we'll get to next. But these next three games are in our, we loved these in 2016 for their story category.
Yeah, collectively, this is the feels awards. These are games that just immerse you in the world, whether it be through clever story writing, emergent atmosphere, like clever dialogue, just games that make you involve yourself in the world. And invest yourself in the world, I suppose, is a better way to put it. And we're going to start off by talking about a sequel to a game that probably would have won this award a couple of years ago if we were doing metagaming. And we're going to talk about Banner Saga 2. So what's your take on Banner Saga 2, Llama?
I play this game like I'm watching a movie that I occasionally have to do a tactical combat in. Right, it's just, I am here to watch these characters have a story and to occasionally choose my own adventure. And it hits those notes perfectly for me. And the tactical system is super unique. You know, at first you look at it and it's grid-based, turn-based. But they've made a couple of decisions about mechanics there that are very different than you expect and can be a little maybe off-putting or at least confusing until you get used to them, but end up making the experience fresh and interesting. And so, you know, the gameplay is good and the story is fantastic and the whole experience is just one that you should have if you haven't.
Yeah, I think that the sort of Nordic mythology that the game is based around is really rich. Mm-hmm. And they've got a lot of reference to draw from. And because of that, they've been able to create a game that feels like it's telling a story of the ages, right? It feels like it's an ancient epic. It feels like an Odysseus or something like that. Because of how it's written and sort of the background that's there, and the artwork and the soundtrack and the story just come together to... I tried to stream Banner Saga 2 and I couldn't do it because every time I started reading dialogue, I would just be reading it in my head in the voices of the characters. And every time we were advancing across the landscape, I would be zoning out and not reading chat because I was just marveling at the backgrounds and enjoying the soundtrack. So
yeah, I tried to stream this game and I didn't want to because I didn't want to steal the story from people
or from myself. I was purely selfish, to be honest, Llama. Like, I needed to play that game sitting down, you know, with the room dimly lit, with, you know, an ice cold beer and a Viking helmet on. And just, you know, like, put myself in there because it was just so well written.
Yeah. The next story and writing award.
Yeah, so this is one that you haven't played yet.
Right, I'm going to be largely silent here.
Yeah, I'm going to implore you to play it. In fact, when you find yourself with probably, like, two streams, this is not a long game.
Right. I've been implored to play this, and every time I am implored to play this, I think, yes, very soon, and I don't know why I keep not playing it. This is one, it's on my short list of things to do next.
Okay. It's a game called The Turing Test, which was recently published by Square Enix. I don't remember the name of the developer, though. The game is really good. So it's a first-person puzzle game set on Europa, one of Jupiter's moons. And it's a puzzler in the same respect that Portal is a puzzler. It uses, a first-person puzzle-solving mechanic, so you're solving puzzles in a three-dimensional space. Now, for the most part, the puzzles aren't super complex. But I think the puzzles are mostly there to enable the game to tell its story, because the atmosphere in the Turing Test and the story that it tells are chilling. Incredibly sort of this isolationist story, you know, dealing with artificial intelligence and robotics and space travel, and it's just, I don't want to, obviously we're trying to avoid spoilers here, but I can tell you right now that if you have any interest in robotics or artificial intelligence, if you have any interest in human evolution or space travel, if you have any interest in sort of isolationist style lore, you should definitely play through the Turing test. Even if you find the puzzles too easy, there's a couple of good ones in there. I won't spoil them. But for the most part, the game is all about just taking on the role of Ava from the International Space Agency and finding out why the crew has disappeared from the ground station on Europa. It's really, really good.
Awesome.
Really good.
It's great to have a good puzzle game in the story category instead of in the good puzzle game category. That's, I don't know. I really appreciate story in games.
I think, like, Turing Test reviewed very, very positively. And I think that if Turing Test had come out before Portal was released, Turing Test would be hailed as probably the best first-person puzzler ever.
It just has the misfortune of having such an outlier to compete with.
I'm not going to, like, that's not me saying that the Turing Test is better than Portal. Portal is a brilliant game with amazing humor, but the Turing Test is always going to be unfairly judged against Portal, and it's a completely different feel of game. So,
the next game in this category is a little bit different. The first two had good gameplay, great story. And this one is in this category because the story is so exquisitely done, for me at least, that it overcomes some gameplay deficits.
We're going to be talking about Tyranny.
Yeah.
Another Paradox title that makes it onto the list. Well, Paradox published it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Tyranny, for me, had, playing on the highest difficulty, Tyranny had a really interesting early game. A fairly interesting middle game, and a kind of lackluster late game.
I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about the gameplay mechanics, because
there
were some flaws in them, and we are celebrating good games here.
Exactly. However,
I do want to put the caveat on there. The gameplay mechanics were a little bit of a turnoff for me, but it was worth it for the world building and the story they're telling. And the other thing that Tyranny did that was masterfully executed for me was the idea that you are playing as the bad guy. The game is about being evil. And they left you with a lot of choice while forcing you to be evil. And it was an amazing thing they pulled off.
A lot of RPGs struggle with the good versus evil morality style. There's normally one clear-cut decision, and they're so polar opposite, like, so different that it's painfully obvious which is the right choice,
mm-hmm.
or the choice that makes the most sense for your character. But there were a lot of decisions in Tyranny where I had to sit and think.
Yeah.
I had to sit and, like, get into the mind of my character and think,
yeah,
what is my character's motivation? Like, which of these awful choices, in my mind, would make the most sense in my character's mind?
And that was one of the things that they did so well was, you know, a lot of RPGs, you pick a broad character archetype, and then there is exactly one option that fits it.
Yep.
And so you're not really role-playing, you're just, it's like those Facebook quizzes, which superhero are you? And it's super obvious which one gets you the superhero you want, and you just pick that option. Tyranny doesn't do that. I had to, like, I couldn't metagame it. I had to pick the thing that felt in character, and I had to roleplay in a way that I haven't roleplayed in an RPG ever, because the consequences weren't clear, and the writing was so good that I was in the world and just masterfully done.
And one of the things that a lot of RPGs struggle with, and Tyranny excelled at, was writing interesting NPCs. NPCs that joined the party all had very interesting story arcs, and, like, if a little inflexible, incredibly, like, interesting personalities that were wide and varied.
And you liked them or you hated them, and it felt good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So, Tyranny makes it onto the list for a game with incredible story and writing. So let's move on to the other half of the Feels Awards, which is the Atmosphere and Setting Awards. So these are games that, you know, maybe the writing was really good, maybe the story was really good, but what really made the game pop was how you felt when you played it. Like, the despair that it instilled, or the loneliness, or, like, just the feeling just, of the game, which is hard to quantify.
I mean, I'm calling it atmosphere, and it's influenced by writing, so we're trying not to make one of these the writing award and the other one not. It's just that this writing wasn't about narrative, this writing was about setting an atmosphere and emotion more than anything else. And there's a lot of things that go into that, sound design, art design. But the whole package together, this category is for atmosphere.
And so let's start with one of the most well-received games on Twitch ever.
Yeah, this one is we're cheating a little bit. It did get released in January 2016, so we're not cheating a lot. But this game was around long before 2016.
We are talking about Darkest Dungeon.
The Darkest Dungeon.
The darkest, dankest of dungeons.
And before we talk about the game itself, I want to talk about the developer, because they did some things that were awesome. As a developer interacting with the community, their game was well received on Twitch, as you said. And then the developer took how they were received on Twitch and spent a bunch of money and time and effort thanking Twitch streamers by getting their sound design team and their voice actor to record a bunch of stuff to give to streamers for free. Because, I mean, what a great developer. What an awesome community-focused game dev.
I think that the developers of Darkest Dungeon have taken a step in the direction that all developers should pay a lot of attention to. Because right now, I think that streaming and YouTubing, I think that, like, interactive media on the web is hands down the number one source of advertising you can get in the current environment, right? In the current market. I don't think game magazines, I don't think, you know, ads are anywhere near as important as getting your game exposed on platforms like Twitch and YouTube. Yep. I think that's way more important than anything else that you can do.
Yeah. So, you know, that was my side note. But this game, despite having a wonderful dev who interacts with the community well, is also just brilliant. If you enjoy Lovecraftian horror as a setting, and you want to immerse yourself in some great sound design, some great art design, and just a dark, terrifying atmosphere, this is your game, Darkest Dungeon.
And the game has, like, gone from strength to strength. We originally played it back when it very first released. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the mechanics have actually changed since then because of feedback from the community. And the game has just continued to get better. Yep. And every time you load up Darkest Dungeon, and every time you enter one of the dungeons, you feel like everything could go wrong. It instills a kind of horror that, like, belies its almost sort of cartoony cel-shaded design.
Yeah.
It just feels dark. And yeah. So it gets a thumbs up. It gets a double thumbs up from me. It's just a great game.
Yeah. And we have this in the atmosphere category, but it could also go in one of our later categories for innovation, because they did some really unique things in their gameplay design as well. It's just, it's good on a lot of levels.
It really is. Next up is a game that I've not played, and so I'm going to stay relatively silent. Llama, this is like a game that you are a little, you've got a bit of a crush.
Yeah, this is
on this one.
This is my, in addition to being a great atmosphere game, which is why it's in this category, this next game is my, if you haven't heard of this, I implore you to play it. Because I had such an experience. This game took me on a trip, and I lost myself, and I just lived in their world, and went on the emotional journey that they designed for me, and I loved it the whole time. The game is The Flame in the Flood. It's a survival game, which is another genre that I don't typically love. But they drive it forward by having you float down a river. That's the main conceit. You stop on the side of the river and gather supplies and take them to your raft and continue floating down the river. And, you know, the river's a big character in the story. And the art design is unique. And the story that they tell is interesting. And the music in the game sets the atmosphere, and I just got to sit and experience the emotions they intended for me, and it just felt so good. Felt so good.
I haven't played it. Yeah, I can't really weigh in on it because I've not played it, but I've heard great things from other people as well. So
yeah,
I might have to pick it up and give it a shot someday. When I find the time. what's next?
So this is...
Oh, it's another cheaty.
Yeah.
It's another... We're going to cheat again. This is a game that Llama's been playing a lot recently. We're going to talk about it because it got an expansion recently. So that qualifies as being a new game, right, Llama? Right?
Yeah. part of this game released this year. So it's on this year's list. And if you don't like it, tough. You're not in charge of me. This is my show. and we're talking about this game today.
Yeah, we're going to talk a little bit about Sunless Sea. Specifically, the Submariner expansion, because that's what came out in 2016.
Right. Submariner is our excuse to talk about Sunless Sea right now.
Yeah. Sunless Sea. Do you know, so Sunless Sea, before I'd loaded it up and played it, before I had even, you know, created my first ship's captain, when I booted up Sunless Sea and was presented with the haunting melody on the load, like the main menu, and the background image on the main menu, I was immediately transported to Fallen London. The game, for me, I think the sound design... Like the soundtrack for Sunless Sea does such a strong, like such strong work at just immediately immersing you in the game, and the writing and the setting and the way you have to manage your terror and everything in that game just lends itself to this sort of melancholy, haunted underground ocean. In this sort of fantasy Fallen London setting that just, there's something about the game that just makes me want to be an Unterunterzee captain.
It is, it is beautifully done. I found the gameplay hard to understand and hard to get into, but I just didn't care. Because what I wanted to do was slowly float to the next port and then read some great text and then float to the next port and read some great text. And it didn't matter that I wasn't making progress in the game, and it doesn't matter that I don't understand how to make progress in the game, because that's not what I'm playing for. I just want to find the next part of the little vignettes. You know, there isn't sort of one overarching storyline, which is why this game's in the atmosphere category and not the story category. But there are all these great little vignettes that reveal facets of the setting. And I am loving my playthrough of this.
To top it off, this year Sunless Sea is going to be coming to iPad. So all of you people who have been crying out for like real games for your tablets, keep your eyes open, because this is, you know, potentially going to happen. Oh, well, no, it's definitely going to happen. It's going to be happening in a couple of months. But
this
will be a great way to spend your time.
Yeah, this would be a great game on a tablet. Before I played video games for a living, I spent a lot of time pulling out a tablet to kill a few minutes. And this game would be great for that. If you want, you know, to just, like, sail your boat around the Untersee, you know, and sort of relax for a minute, you get that, and you read some stories, and yeah, what a great fit.
My greatest fear with Sunless Sea coming to tablet devices is that there are going to be a whole lot of people at work who just never leave the bathroom. that's my fear, because this game will suck you in, and before you know it, it'll be knockoff time, and you'll have been in the bathroom all day. It's just, it's so immersive. All right, we're going to move on to a category which is a little odd.
Yeah.
Because some of these games are going to be a little bit divisive, and they're more board gamey, card gamey games. They're all electronic, but all three of these, the next three in the board game alike category, is what we're going to be calling it, are games that I highly rate. And we're going to start with a game that, honestly, at the beginning of the year, I called this as one of my favorite games of the year before I'd even seen everything else that came out this year. And that's Tharsis.
And this is held up for you as one of your best games of the year?
Yeah. I still think that Tharsis could also end up in the atmosphere category. It could also end up in the interestingly weird category. It's just a really great game. It uses random number generation in a really interesting way. It has an interesting setting. It has that seat of your pants sort of right on the edge style of gameplay that I really like. You're always like, you always need just one more dice. Just one more dice to be able to beat challenges.
Yeah.
And it holds up as one of the best dice-based games I've ever seen.
whoops. Sorry, I just messed up the visuals.
That's right.
Tharsis is one of... I sort of love it as a... Hey, this could be on cardboard. Oh, but really it couldn't. Because how would you generate the events that happen? And how would you work in the stress system that's a little bit too granular for cardboard? It feels like a board game. And so that gives me some nostalgia sensibilities a little bit. One of the great things about Tharsis is that a game of it is pretty quick. You know, you can sit down and knock out a round of Tharsis in a few minutes and lose and then start over and do it again. You know, it fits in a much smaller time scale than some of the games we talked about earlier, like Rimworld or Factorio, which will eat your weekend and you will wonder what happened to it. You know, Tharsis fits a different space where you can just, like, knock out a game real quick and play some puzzles and roll some dice, and it's good.
Yeah, I think the reason that Tharsis sticks out for me is just because they managed to take something so... It's kind of like Yahtzee.
Yeah.
Like, they took something so benign, something old and worn and tired, and gave it a fresh coat of paint and added cannibalism, and, like, just gave you this game that is interesting mechanically, and they've continued to provide some additional content updates with missions and things as well, which has made the game better. It just... Everything about the game just makes me want to play... just want to play it more. And unfortunately, I don't get a chance to play it as much as I'd like. But if you've not checked out Tharsis, one caveat, if you are somebody who will get grumpy and throw the dice across the room when playing Monopoly with your friends, or Yahtzee, maybe this isn't the game for you. Because there's some pretty, pretty rage-inducing moments in Tharsis. At times.
If you like your games to be hard and you don't mind them occasionally being impossible, then Tharsis, it will sometimes randomly just be too difficult. There will be moments where you can't win, or you could win, but the dice don't go that way. And yeah, if that upsets you, this game might make you upset.
Quite possibly. What about the... So this next game, this is a secret. I think the number of people who know about this game is probably, like, in the thousands.
Yeah, this is one that you introduced me to, and I'm going to let you do most of the talking here like I did with Tharsis. I think you...
Okay, I'm going to talk about a little game here.
But I do want to say I'm glad you showed it to me. And this is sort of your The Flame in the Flood for today. This is the one that you're like, if you haven't heard of this, go hear of this, right?
Yeah. So I'm going to talk about a game called Frost. It's only like $7. It's really cheap. It was made by a single guy. It's available on Steam. It has a total of 28 reviews, all right? And they're positive. It's a quiet game. Frost is a deck-building game. It's a single-player deck-building game set in a world where you must constantly be outrunning a massive snowstorm. And to do that, you have to overcome challenges as you move from place to place. And you do that by building up a deck of cards. Now, Frost is interesting in that it is kind of like a legacy game. As you play the game more and beat it and finish challenges and beat the game in different ways, you'll add new and interesting cards to your deck and to the enemy event deck. So you end up in a position where, as the game progresses, as you beat the game, it continues to evolve. And that's very interesting. The aesthetic is a little weird and might be a little too bright for some people because it's a lot of white. But it also creates a fairly interesting sort of immersive aesthetic because you feel like you're in this frozen wild. It's really fun, and it's mostly unknown, but it's a really great game. I really enjoyed playing it.
Yeah, if you like card games, and if you like deck builders as a card game conceit, you know, this is a good game to fill in to scratch that itch. As a solo game, instead of having to, like, arrange time with friends to bust out a box of cards and sit down. You know, this... I really, really enjoyed Frost when you suggested it. Great suggestion.
And finally, there's another game on the list. This one's one that Llama has yet to play.
Yep, this one is going to be all you, kind of like Frost was.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about a board game that came out. I did it. Some coverage of it with the Board Game Night crew on YouTube. It's a game called Gremlins, Inc. Gremlins Inc. is a board game style. It really could be a board game, right? Where you control a gremlin, funnily enough, who is trying to amass as many victory points as possible to win the game. You move around a board with multiple paths and land on spaces that you then have to take an action on. The game is very adversarial. You are constantly in competition with your opponents, and there are a lot of different ways that you can mess with them while they're trying to travel around the board as well. On top of that, it uses a really interesting mechanic, because instead of moving around the board by rolling dice, you move around the board by spending cards in your hand. Each card has a dice value associated with it, so certain cards will allow you to move a certain number of spaces. More powerful cards will allow you to move further, but they also might earn you more money or more victory points, or, you know, allow you to achieve certain actions that you wouldn't be able to achieve without using those cards. So you're constantly having to decide how far you move, when you move. It takes out some of the randomness of the game, because at any given time you'll have six cards in hand, so you can choose from six potential values for your move rather than rolling a single dice. I have played through a few games of Gremlins Inc., and it's a lot of fun. It's a lot more fun with friends. So if you've got a couple of friends who are interested in playing a board game, maybe, you know, you used to play board games with them in the past, or you don't get a chance to anymore because everyone's growing up and having kids and things, you should check out Gremlins Inc. It's a lot of fun.
This is one that I need to get my hands on and try, but I don't know when I'll be able to set up some friends to play with.
I'll play with you, Llama. I'll play with you. Right, our next category, we're going to cheat a little bit on this one as well, which is great. I will start by talking about Stardew Valley. So the meditative category is all about games that allow you to just immerse yourself in the world and just keep playing, right? You just continue to play. You just continue to play. How do you phrase this? You can play mindlessly. You don't have to pay huge amounts of attention to what you're doing. It's basically the kind of game that you can turn on, be watching your favorite television show, and be able to sort of be successful and play the game. It's kind of like a clicker. It just feels like the kind of game that you can just absorb yourself in, right? And not have to pay any attention to. You can just play it. If you're sick and lying in bed and watching a movie, this is the kind of game you want to play. If you have nothing to do and you can't find something else you want to play, this is the kind of game you can load up and just play. It's just meditative. It's also like probably one of the, if not the most polished, well-received indie games of all time. So, yeah, you should definitely check out Stardew Valley if you haven't done so already. It's a really great game. Really great.
Very well received. Not one that I'm going to comment on today because it was not, it didn't hit that for me. And I don't know why. But I know it hit that note for a lot of people. And our meditative game category is one that I really love in general. And the next game in this category, you know what game could have been in this category? Is Sunless Sea, I think.
It could have made it into this category, yeah.
Yeah. And my pick for this category is Kingdom. And we get to talk about Kingdom because the new Lands expansion came out this year. So technically 2016. A lot of our games are in the technically 2016 category. Kingdom, you know, there's not a ton of depth in the gameplay. It's not difficult, but it's pretty and it's soothing and it's distracting. And I need a few games in my library at all times that I can turn on and sit down. Kingdom is played with three buttons, so I can rest three fingers on the arrow keys and just let my mind stop worrying about things. Let my mind experience beauty, just really beautiful pixel art, and just relax and walk left and walk right and experience Kingdom.
Kingdom, like, it's unique, right? Mm-hmm. There are very few games that can get away with you existing on effectively a one-dimensional plane.
Yeah.
Because you exist on a one-dimensional plane in Kingdom. You only have two axes of movement. And I really can't think of another game that does that. Even platformers, you know, you can jump. You can't jump in Kingdom. It's so unique and beautiful, and you can just play it. There's no tutorial, there's no quests, there's no anything that you need to do. You just play. That's great.
Yeah, the game starts up and the title is Stone, and you walk past it and it falls apart and you're on the map. There's nothing but game in the game.
There isn't even a menu, right? Is there a menu? I don't think there's even a menu.
I don't remember if there's a menu. There's got to be options that you can get to somewhere to configure. But really, I mean, it's just you turn it on, you rest three fingers on three buttons on your keyboard, and you relax and enjoy being the king.
Okay. Let's move on to our, well, it's weird, in a good way, category.
Yeah.
These are our interestingly weird games. Games with mechanics or takes on old mechanics that are so far removed from their predecessors, so innovative, so new, so interesting, that they just make the gaming experience completely novel. And we're going to start off with another game that was incredibly well received, and I think everyone should play through it at least once because it's like mind-meltingly good.
Yeah.
It's a game called Super Hot. Llama, you don't hot. Like...
So, yeah, I mean, if you know me, if you watch my channel at all, you know that I don't play shooters, and when I do play shooters, I am horrible. I played The Last of Us recently, and a common refrain in the chat room was, "Man, you make Joel look bad." Which was true.
It was true.
But Super Hot's interesting mechanic is it has this take on time. Time only progresses when you move. Or it progresses really slowly, unless you're doing something. So you get to pull off insanely intricate combos with time sort of paused. So you can dodge bullets, and you can execute several actions really quickly that you wouldn't be able to do with my level of reflexes.
Yeah, Super Hot is a first-person shooter that is actually not a first-person shooter. It's a puzzle game.
Yeah.
It's a game where you're put into a situation where if you were in a first-person shooter, you would die 100% of the time. And it says, right, you can move faster than bullets. You only progress time when you move. How do you deal with this situation? And the gameplay, it just dumps you into situations, right? You're not running around looking for things or, you know, running around in protracted firefights. For the most part, the game is, here is your situation. In real time, it probably takes 15 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
But in the planning and execution and retrying stages, that one level might take you a minute or two or five. And so it artificially extends the length of the game.
Yeah.
And it just feels so much fun. And the other thing that I love about Super Hot is that the story in Super Hot is actually important. In most first-person shooters, the story is just, well, it's a thing. The story is a thing. That was, in Super Hot...
that was the next thing I wanted to say was, this is in this category because the thing, the main thing about the game is that it does this really interesting, innovative take on being a video game mechanically. But it also has this really well-executed story. Incredibly well-executed. And interesting and funny. And this could almost have been in the story or writing category.
Yeah, I think it probably deserves to be in the interestingly weird category more.
Yeah.
But it did have a great story.
Yeah.
Super Hot. Really good game. I think there's a demo available if you're not sure, but you could check out some coverage.
It's also recently available for VR. And when I imagine this system, how much it made me feel like a ninja with a mouse, I can't imagine how much I would feel like a ninja in VR. I might need to buy VR just for Super Hot.
If only I could justify that purchase. Super Hot, really great game. You should check it out.
At the end of the game, it requests that you tell everyone that Super Hot is the most innovative game of the year.
It boldly just
has that in the text of the game. And I don't know that that claim is wrong.
All right, next is a game that crept up on me. I had no idea this existed. And then a friend said, hey, have you heard of Halcyon 6? And I said, no, I haven't heard of Halcyon 6. What on earth is Halcyon 6? And he said, imagine playing Final Fantasy while also playing XCOM, while also playing, like, a space-based 4X. And I said, huh?
Yeah.
And that was pretty much the extent of the conversation. Halcyon 6... is one of the few games I've ever seen that does a significant genre mashup and succeeds.
Yeah, this is in our interestingly weird category because of the genre mashup. Right? They'd have this JRPG plus XCOM base building plus 4X space management, and somehow it all works together and is cohesive.
Yeah. Halcyon 6 is one of those games that I don't think you can you can't really do it justice by explaining it. By trying to explain to someone, well, in combat, it's like a Final Fantasy where you choose your actions for each of your ships, and each of your ships have a class, and they have certain abilities, and you can combo those abilities, but only in certain ways. And then, but you're also creating like this XCOM base layout, but it's a lot bigger than any of the XCOM base layouts. Like, you have so many more rooms to build, but you also have officers that you train, and they level up and get experience, and your ships, you can't summarize the game. All you can do is say it's an incredible mashup of a lot of different genres. It has some really reverential pop culture references and some irreverent ones as well. But it has some really great sort of tongue-in-cheek humor combined with some really great mechanics on both a tactical and strategic layer. And the story's not bad. either.
Yeah, I found the writing had enough character that I could very easily do voice acting for it. And, you know, all of the characters were very silly in their own ways, and, you know, the writing was funny and well done. For sure.
Yeah, I think the big kicker with Halcyon 6 is it's not written as a serious game.
Yep.
It's very much supposed to be a lot of fun, and it definitely doesn't take itself too seriously. And, you know, I don't think it has a huge amount of replayability.
No.
But I still think it's definitely worth picking up for just even the first playthrough.
It's one of these things that you want to go experience because it's unique and interesting. If you are into gaming and game design and looking at something that's unique, is something that you enjoy when you're gaming. Halcyon 6 is one that you don't want to miss.
And finally, in our interestingly weird category, we're going to talk a little bit about an RTS, kind of?
Yeah, this one's in the category because you can't put it in a genre. It plays a little bit like an RTS, but RTSs have armies that fight each other. And Offworld Trading Company just doesn't.
So I don't have huge amounts of experience with Offworld Trading Company. I've only played a little tiny bit of it. And what I've played is nowhere near as much as I've watched. I've enjoyed watching a lot of Offworld Trading Company. But even with the little that I've played and the lot that I've watched, I can safely say that it's a really interesting take on I think it's best to put it into like the competitive RTS strategy, right?
Yep.
Or the competitive RTS category. You're basically economically fighting against another player.
Yeah.
By competing for resources on a map.
It's in the title, Offworld Trading Company, and the primary means of the word my brain is coming up with is combat. Competition. Primary means of competition is financial. And you win by buying out your opponents so that you have a monopoly on the map instead of by beating them up.
Yep. It's a game that I think I would play a lot more if I had some friends who wanted to play it multiplayer.
Yeah.
I have always struggled to get into RTSs in single player mode because typically I find them to be a little simple. Yeah. Not necessarily simple. Simple's the wrong word. But I don't enjoy them as much as when I play them multiplayer. And I haven't had the opportunity to play multiplayer Offworld Trading Company yet. But it looks to be an incredible game to be able to be played multiplayer. And the single player campaigns are interesting as well. If I get the opportunity, I'll probably go through and play all of them. Because it's just such an interesting game. I think it, you know.
Yeah, it's a weird take on. I mean, there are a lot of spreadsheets in this RTS and graphs. And when you sell a lot of water to the market, you can drive the price down. And sometimes that's strategic because your enemy was using it for money and you want to drive the price down on them so they can't. Like, it's so weird that you're doing strategic stock market maneuvering to buy out just the, you know, that core conceit is interestingly weird. It's a neat entry into the RTS genre. It's very neat.
I think just the simple fact that the game provides you with a competitive angle where it's not all about reflexes and micro, it's more about clever decision making and proper planning.
Mm-hmm.
Is what really sort of drives it home for me as a unique, interesting, and great experience. So
yeah, super, super fascinating game.
Okay, Three more on the list.
Yep.
Three more. Now, you'll have noticed that a lot of the stuff we've talked about so far have been indie games. Our next category is a category that has games that could probably fit into most of these categories. They're games that are just fun. You know, they have really solid everything, and we can't really fault them. Doesn't mean they're the best games on the list.
Yeah.
Don't be mistaken.
But we kind of saved them for last on purpose, though, because
yeah,
you know, they are some of the real gems of the year.
Absolutely. I'm going to start off by talking a little bit about one of Firaxis's big releases of the year. Little game called Civilization VI.
Yeah.
Now, Llama, you've not played
Civ. Yeah, this is another one that I won't be able to weigh in on because somehow I've managed to not play it. I don't know how, but somehow I have.
Have you played much Civilization in the past?
No, I think the last Civilization I played was 2.
Wow. Okay. Well, we definitely have to get you onto some Civ 6 at some point, just for funsies.
Yeah.
So, Civilization 6, I have this irrational fear of Civilization games because of the nature of their releases, right? They normally come out and they're not as good as the previous one, and then they get a few DLCs and expansions and they become as good as the previous ones, and then they get a couple more and they become better, and then the whole cycle repeats. And it's kind of happened a few times, so I'm skeptical. But Civilization VI is really great. I was pleasantly surprised. So I will be honest with you, I am a cynical old grumpy man, and I was pleased. So that should sort of sing its praises immediately. The thing about Civ 6 that I like is that they actually spend some time innovating and changing the way the game works. Between Civilization 5 and Beyond Earth, there wasn't a huge amount of change to the gameplay in Civilization, and that kept the experience very similar. With Civilization 6, I find myself spending a lot more time planning ahead and making decisions about what I want to do rather than just playing on autopilot, which is how I used to play Civilization 5. The graphics are gorgeous. The gameplay is solid. The voice acting is great. The systems are all quite interesting. If I had one criticism to level at the game, it would be that the expansions haven't come out yet, so we have very few new races. I think only 2 additional races have been added to the game. And I'm spoiled because I've played lots of Civilization 5 where there are many, many, many more civilizations than there are in the current game. That being said, Civilization 6 is great. And I think it is better than Civilization 5. And I think that Firaxis did a fantastic job getting out a game that was polished and worked well. There's still some minor gripes with AI and stuff, but Firaxis has been working hard to get that fixed up. And Civilization 6 is a blast. If you're into Civilization games or 4X games in general, highly recommend it. Highly recommend it.
Awesome. The next entry in our just fun to play category is one that I've played and you haven't, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Go
swapsies.
I didn't play this on stream. I played it on its free weekend for like 2 hours just to see what all the hype was about. This is a really bizarre entry for our show because it is a mainstream first-person shooter. I'm going to talk for just a few seconds about Overwatch. Yeah. Yeah, Overwatch. Me. So, here's the thing. I'm going to be brief. Overwatch did, when I played it for 2 hours, exactly what I expected a Blizzard game to do. It took a genre at which I am terrible, made it feel like I was good at it, and I had fun anyway. That's, I don't know how Blizzard does that repeatedly in multiple genres. I don't know. They're very good at it, though, and Overwatch hits those notes. It's a first-person shooter game. I am terrible at first-person shooters. This is well known. I had fun. I won matches. I felt influential in a positive way for a couple hours. Game is good. It's just good. It's fun. You can have fun at it when you're bad at it, like I do.
I never played Overwatch. Playing online shooters in Australia is difficult. Community is much, much smaller. And not very pleasant, if I'm being honest. So I tend to stay away from those sorts of things. But from what I've seen, Overwatch looks really, really good. Which doesn't surprise me at all. Blizzard has this special black magic voodoo power that just makes all of their games addictive and great. It's definitely not skill, experience, and money. You know.
No, it's magic.
It's magic.
Yeah.
Plenty of other studios have skill, experience, and money and manage to turn out complete turds. But I don't know, Blizzard pretty much nails everything they ever release. So.
They did the same thing with Heroes of the Storm, where they took a genre, the MOBA genre, that has a pretty high barrier to entry sometimes, and an extensive metagame that you need to study, and can be hard to play, and you play it poorly. And they just made it fun, and you felt like you were good at it. The same thing with Overwatch. It's good. It's fun. It's pretty. It's Blizzard. Play it. It's good. That's all. I don't know that there's much more to say than that.
Okay, Llama. The grand finale. Now,
people are going to be so surprised.
I know.
No one's going to predict this.
No, absolutely not. Let's talk about one of the best games of the year. It's a AAA title. You know, me and Llama, we don't really like AAA titles. We don't play a lot of the AAA stuff that comes out. But this one, let's talk a little bit about XCOM 2. XCOM 2.
Who's surprised that we liked this game?
Yeah.
So I'm going to start XCOM with criticism 2. So then we can gush afterward.
All right, you do the criticism.
I'm
going to
dispel the haters who are going to complain that we're gushing about this game. If you want to complain that this game is a little bit unoptimized, you are not wrong. But shut up. It's fine. Yes, game's a little unoptimized. That is a valid complaint. We've all heard you. You can stop harping on it.
Yeah, there's... The only criticisms that I have, right, so we're doing the criticisms first, then we're going to gush for 10 minutes, and then you have to run and pick up Fuzzy. So, the only two criticisms I have for XCOM 2 is it has some performance issues even now, and it doesn't have Long War yet.
Yeah.
The story, way better than original Enemy Within. The gameplay, better than the original Enemy Within. The graphics, better than original Enemy Within. The engine, better than original Enemy Within. Customization, if you look at Enemy Within versus XCOM 2, XCOM Enemy Within was a great game. XCOM 2 is better in every single way than its predecessor, which is really hard to do.
I say this a lot. People ask me all the time, what's better, XCOM 2 or Long War? Don't make the comparison until Long War 2 comes out, then we'll talk.
Yeah.
But my answer is that with the exception of optimization and some glitchiness that is sort of the XCOM hallmark, with that one exception, XCOM 2 is a perfect case study in how to do a sequel.
Yep.
It is exactly what you want your sequel to be. It continues telling the story. They made some weird choices that people might not agree with in how to treat their old story. So I'm not going to talk about that. But it feels the same, right? The gameplay is the same enough that it feels nostalgic and it feels good, and the gameplay is different enough that it's a new game. It is all the things you said about being better and better and better and better are absolutely true. It's just, it is a case study in how to do sequels correctly.
However, as Long War veterans, I think we can call ourselves veterans with literally thousands of hours played between the two of us. Mm-hmm. Shameful as that might sound to people who don't play video games for a living. XCOM 2's biggest sort of point of failure for us, or me specifically, I'm talking for you, but I'm sure you'll agree, is the fact that we are so used to Long War that XCOM 2 felt easy and the decisions didn't feel important enough, like on soldier level ups and things.
That issue is so unique to us.
Yeah, exactly. And I think if you can distance yourself from Long War, if you had never played Long War, if you played Enemy Within and then XCOM 2, if you'd never played Long War and you just played XCOM 2, you would hail it as an incredible advancement in the XCOM universe and in the genre, right?
Yeah.
And it's just Long War that gets in the way of that.
Mm.
And Firaxis themselves, I think, are very well aware of how influential and important Long War was to the long-term success of XCOM.
Yep.
And because of that, they've employed Pavonis to create Long War 2. If you hadn't heard it yet, this is only like a week late, if you haven't heard it yet. But Long War 2 is confirmed, it is coming. So, you know, hopefully Long War 2 puts back in all of the difficulty and length and depth that Long War had in the new engine with all of the new fancy shiny things. And, you know, when that happens, it might finally be time for me to put Long War up on the naughty shelf forever.
Yeah.
And move on to Long War 2.
Absolutely. Well done. Good game.
Yeah.
It's been, you know, it was that I think they did it exactly right. They did a perfect sequel.
Yeah, they just did an incredible job. And like, you know, some of the mechanics are a little controversial. Some people don't like certain mechanics in the game.
And you know what, honestly, mod it. It's got mod support. If you don't like the timers, take them out. Yep. If you don't like the alien rulers, don't use the DLC. I think both of those things add some interesting choices. And if nothing else, some interesting knobs to tune to make the game play the way you want it to play. And they add depth to the systems of the game. And I think that's what sequels should do, is add depth to the systems of the game. And if you don't like it, you can turn it off.
At the end of the day, you're playing it for fun. If it's not fun for you, okay. I love it, though. Llama, we find ourselves with a couple of minutes spare at the end of this metagaming series. Is there anything else that we wanted to talk about today? Anything there's one thing we should probably talk about. I don't know if you paid attention or watched the event, but the Nintendo Switch has been fully revealed.
Oh, yeah.
You seen that?
I haven't seen it other than noticing that the Nintendo Switch reveal is everywhere.
Yeah. For me, I'm a little frustrated with Nintendo right now because they've revealed the Switch and given us none of the technical bits.
Yeah.
Right? I have no problem. Like, some people have a real foul taste in their mouth because Nintendo's fallen behind the console war for a long time, right? They went in a different direction they've been beaten out for so long. I don't think anyone cares really about a lot of the stuff that's been announced about the console. What most people care about, what most gamers care about now, especially gamers in the sort of high teens, early 20s and on, We care about what the system's capable of, right? See, I want to know what the GPU is, what the CPU is.
I'm going to disagree, specifically because Nintendo. I think Nintendo has consistently, for a long time, just sidestepped the competition between the other console makers. You know, they're going to tell you about how many 4K resolutions they have, and you know, that's the Xbox PlayStation competition. Nintendo just wants to innovate controllers. That's what they want to do. They want to make Wii nunchucks, and they want to make a little thing that you can pull the screen out of the thing and take the controllers apart and put the controllers together. And that's, you know, they're not interested in having the best GPU. The other two people can go have that contest. And Nintendo is just going to make a new Zelda game with a new control scheme, and you're going to buy it because you like Nintendo. And I feel like they exist in a different tangential space to the other consoles, and it doesn't bother me that they don't release their specs. Because if I buy a Nintendo, I'm not buying it to compete with my PlayStation. I'm buying it because I want to play Mario and Zelda.
Yeah, but do you want to play Mario and Zelda that could have been released on PlayStation 2? Yes. Or do you want to be playing Mario and Zelda that could have been released on PlayStation 4?
I know that I am weird, and I know that I am wrong, but I don't get the largest part of my gaming enjoyment from those sweet resolutions and those high-K graphics. Like, I just, it doesn't matter to me more than gameplay and story and all the categories we had today. How many of our categories today were most bestest shiny ray tracers? Like, I just don't care.
You're right. The reason I care, is not because I want the best graphics. It's because I want a console that isn't going to be completely outdated in 12 months. I want a console that developers are actually interested in developing for. I want a console.
Yeah.
And I want a console that, you know, like the you know, it's all well and good buying it to play the Mario and Zelda game, but then you're paying $600 in Australia
for two games.
For two games.
Yeah. Like, and that is the problem with Nintendo being weird and on the outside and doing what Nintendo does so well, is that developers are like, are we going to put this on the Nintendo system? No. I don't want to have to deal with programming for their controller. It's so much easier to just port it between Windows, Xbox, PS4. And so, you know, the system doesn't get supported because it's not powerful enough to run the games, and the control schemes are weird, and that is an issue.
Yeah.
Absolutely is.
And so I need to know, you know, I would love to be able to play the new Zelda and new Mario. I haven't played. I didn't own a Wii. I didn't own a Wii U. I'd like to pick up the Switch. I really like the idea of being able to pick up my screen and go sit on the loo and play Zelda, you know, or curl up in bed and play Zelda and then decide to go outside for a cigarette or whatever and play Zelda and have it with me at all times without having a DS, you know, like having a piece of hardware that's actually viable, but I need to know that it's actually viable, and there's no way for me to tell that until I know what the system's actually capable of. So, you know, I really would have liked to see at the console reveal the technical specifications of the actual hardware. Right now they're being super vague about it, which just puts a filthy taste in my mouth. So
and that is a valid concern. It's just not my concern.
Yeah.
For sure.
All right. Well,
I need to run. I am out of time for this recording today. So thanks for joining me. Go back through the thing. And if there are any of these games you missed, seriously consider trying them. Flame in the Flood.
A couple are really...
Go do it. It's good.
Frost. It's like $6. There's some really great games in there, and some of them are quite cheap. You should definitely have a look at them. Anyway, Llama, thank you for having me, as always.
Yeah, thanks for joining me.
This has been fun.
All right, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. This has been MetaGaming. You have been MetaGamed.